this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and bring the homeless poor into your house? Will you see the naked to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own hand? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healer shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your God. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, here I am. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry, and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like noonday. The Lord will guide you continually.
ministers, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet, among the mature, we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age, who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord for it. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love Him, these things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. The Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human beings knows what is truly human except the human spirit that is within? So also, no one comprehends what is truly God's except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. And we speak of these things in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual things to those who are spiritual. Those who are unspiritual do not receive the gifts of God's Spirit. They are foolishness to them. They are unable to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. Those who are spiritual discern all things. They are themselves subject to no one else's scrutiny. For who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Churches, certainly Episcopal churches and many mainline Protestant churches and Catholic churches, and even some of the evangelical ones that were booming, 20 years ago, to hear a very common story, a common complaint is like, the good old days were back then. We were filled with families and children and young people and older adults, and we were all together, and the pews were packed, and we were able to do so much with that. We were able to go out there and serve the poor, and we were able to put together these great social programs and fundraising programs, and we could do all this stuff, and there's a kind of a sense of mourning and loss and fear. It's like, is what I love so much still going to be here 20 years from now, or 50 years from now, or 100 years from now? And how do we get it back? How do we save it before it's too far gone? And we look to figures like clergy in the hope that they will do this magic thing that changes the tide society's in. And I'll tell you now that the tides of society are well beyond my control. And they do come and go, and whatever goes around comes around, but none of us has a magic formula to bring it back to the glory days. But I think we do know from the scriptures what we are called to do in these times. There is an enormous distinction made in the readings today between living your faith and performing your faith. The people of Israel in Isaiah, like many of us, are saying, "God, where are you? We're singing our hymns, we're bowing, we're doing our sacrifices, we're jumping through hoops, we're doing all this stuff. Why aren't you sending us relief?" And continue to quarrel with one another. You continue to point fingers at one another of accusation. You don't change the structures of oppression among you. So your prayers don't mean much, as Hamlet's uncle and stepfather said in Hamlet, "My words rise up, but my thoughts remain here below. Words without thoughts never to heaven go." If I lie with the rulers of this age, they're closed to receiving the Spirit. And so we can put on the most beautiful liturgies, we can put on the most beautiful fundraisers and social events, and even do good works, but if it isn't touching and changing our hearts, it isn't what's needed. And what's needed is for us to be salt and light. And leave to God what happens to Emmanuel, what happens to the Episcopal Church, what happens to any church. Things come and go in cycles, in their own cycles. Our job is to be faithful, not just to perform our faith, but to live it, to put away the quarrels, the oppression. And Jesus describes our organic relationship to the world outside of this place, to all those we meet and to the people we don't meet, we might just see our building as they drive by. You are salt of the earth and light of the world. When we say some of the salt of the earth, we usually mean that it's just a great person, but salt has a very specific function. In the days before refrigeration, salt is what you use to preserve meat so it does not decay. Salt preserves, and salt adds flavor. It's very desirable. My dad used to put salt on his hand, which is beyond me, but it's but salt makes things taste better. And Jesus says, great, but what if the salt goes flat? What if it loses flavor, which apparently it can do, not entirely, but it can fade? It isn't good for anything. So salt's acting like salt, saying it's salt, but it's not doing what salt does. It hasn't accomplished the mission. The same with light. We often, if you want to figure out when I say Jesus is the light of the world, doesn't mean I just look to Jesus, because most of us don't look at the light. We look at what the light allows us to see. I arrived in darkness this morning, wasn't paying attention, and walked right into the organ, thinking I was at the aisle, because I didn't have light showing me where things were. And I also wasn't paying attention. My head was somewhere else. But there's light allows us to see things as they really are. So Jesus, as the light of the world, allows us to see things as they really, really are. And we, as people of faith, are called to be that light for other people. They should be able to look to your good deeds and my good deeds and say, wow, that person's surreal. They're not just performing. They're not just putting on a beautiful religious show. That person is walking their talk. And we do that in the ways in which we encounter others, in the ways in which we work for justice in our world. If I want to be of Christ, I can't be put away the reality of the virus of racism that, despite the progress we've made, continues to flow through the veins of our society. I can't be indifferent to those who are mistreated because they're different. The immigrant, whether they're here documented or not, the LGBTQ person, the lonely older person, the person who doesn't look like me, or vote like me, or talk like me, or act like me, the person I don't know what to make of. If I can't love, if I can't include, I'm not being salt and I'm not being loved. If I'm caught up in my own quarrels and petty concerns, I'm not being salt and I'm not being light. But we are called to be salt and light. Our focus on knowing Christ and being known by Christ and being transformed by Christ, to walk on that authentic path, that conversion. I was talking to someone about a religious, famous religious leader, actually, by John Paul II. I remember thinking when he came to the United States in 1999, I thought, I disagreed with him on a lot of things, but I thought, you could look at this guy and know he means it. You know he's the real deal. You meet people and you know they're the real deal. Our job is to be the real deal, to be the salt that preserves and flavors things, to be the light that shines and allows people to see more clearly. We do that in all the encounters we have in the workplace, in school, with family, with friends, with strangers on the street or in a store. Everywhere we go, we have a chance to be salt and light, focused on Christ. Our job is not to be spiffy. I love the words of Paul today, saying that I came among onion, not with some slick message, and like you could see from televangelists or something like that, but it very directly. I was determined to know nothing but Jesus and Him crucified. I know that Christ died for me. That the sign of the cross is a sign of how far God is willing to go to rescue you and me and all of us together in this human race. I want to walk in that. We need to recommit ourselves every day to being salt, to being light, to being authentic. Live faithful and not just perform. Amen. Together, let us profess the faith of the Church in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
Lord, have mercy.
Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. Glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Meeting of best
who have need asylum so they don't have to return to Russia, which is dangerous for them to do at this time. And to raise money to help for that, there will be a concert and a silent auction. So at St. Paul's, just down the street, at 2 o'clock next Saturday. Next Sunday, we have all kinds of things going on. Noah and Clara Costner, you may have known, were married in the court on January 6th, and they are coming here for us to bless their marriage as a community, and that will happen next week during our 10 a.m. service. And along with that, they will be renewing their baptismal pledges, which each of them was baptized, doubtless in the eyes of God, but in the eyes of the church, we can't find the paperwork, and all this stuff, so to fulfill all righteousness, we're doing what's called a conditional baptism. But the whole point of that is so that they can recapitulate the faith that is already theirs, and to bless them on their faith journey and on their marital journey as they prepare for the birth of their son Matthias in about another week. So please keep Noah and Clara in your prayers as they prepare for these big days, and we'll be celebrating those next Sunday. Next Sunday at 11:45, we will be having our annual meeting. Please, if you are a member of the church, make every effort to be there. We need your support. We need the quorum to deliberate and pray over our direction and to elect new vestry members and officers to ratify our budget, to discern together where we've been and where God is calling us. So please mark that on your calendar as well. Looking beyond the more fun things, on March the 5th, the Otterbein University Choir is, I'm trying to find them in here so I can get it right. The Otterbein University Concert Choir is going to perform here at Emmanuel on Sunday, March the 5th at 5:30. It's free, and the concert entitled Earth, Sacred Treasure features the music of a number of composers, including Byrd and Mozart. And they are a very select group that travels around the country and around the world, and we're honored to have them here, and I hope people will come in droves. We've talked about the fundraiser, we've talked about that, the annual meeting. Adult Forum is continuing every week at 9 o'clock. We have been talking about different aspects of the Book of Common Prayer, which is really a way of talking about all our life of faith. And beginning Sunday the 25th, we're planning to begin Episcopal 101, which is a class for those who have yet to be baptized or confirmed, or simply want to be refreshed in their faith or are inquiring about the Episcopal Church and the faith. So all those things are coming, and I'm sure I forgot something. I'm going to look through all the pages and see what they study. Oh, the Messiah. I almost forgot the Messiah. The Messiah, and you're welcome to join our choir to perform Handel's Messiah on Sunday, April 16th. Seniors of all experience levels are welcome, and rehearsals are Wednesday nights from 7:30 to 8:30, and certain Sundays from 1 to 2, 12 to 26, March 12th and March 26th. If you have questions, see the Reverend Dr. Scott Rieker, who is back there by the oral. I believe that covers everything. Is there anything I missed? Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken to the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, guide us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with all the saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation.
By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Thank you.
heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him and to you and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Go forth in peace. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all persons. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you.